Section 0 of Whatnot, Wellington. Whatnot by Rose Macaulay. Front matter. Wisdom is very unpleasant to the unlearned. He that is without understanding will not remain with her. She will lie upon him as a mighty stone of trial, and he will cast her from him ere it be long. For wisdom is according to her name, and she is not manifest unto many. Desire not a multitude of unprofitable children. Jesus, son of Sirach, B.C. 150. It's domesticness of spirit, selfishness, which is the great let to armies, religions, and kingdoms good. W. Greenhill, 1643. It has come to a fine thing if people cannot live in their homes without being interfered with by the police. You are upsetting the country altogether with your food orders and whatnot. Defendant in a food hoarding case, January 1918. Note, as this book was written during the war, and intended prophetically, its delay until some months after the armistice calls for a word of explanation. The book was ready for publication in November 1918, when it was discovered that a slight alteration in the text was essential to safeguard it against one of the laws of the realm. As the edition was already bound, this alteration has naturally taken a considerable time. However, as the date of the happenings described in Whatnot is unspecified, it may still be regarded as a prophecy, not yet disproved. R.M. March 1919. Apology. One cannot write forevermore of life in wartime, even if, as at times seems possible, the war outlasts the youngest of us. Nor can one easily write of life as it was before this thing came upon us, for that is a queer, half-remembered thing to make one cry. This is a tale of life after the war, in which alone there is hope. So it is, no doubt, inaccurate, too sanguine in part, too pessimistic in part, too foolish and too far removed from life as it will be lived even for a novel. It is a shot in the dark, a bow drawn at a venture. But it is the best one can do in the unfortunate circumstances, which make against all kinds of truth, even that inferior kind which is called accuracy. Truth, indeed, seems to be one of the things, along with lives, wealth, joy, leisure, liberty, and forest trees, which has to be sacrificed on the altar of this all-taking war, this bitter, unsparing God, which may perhaps before the end strip us of everything we possess except the integrity of our so fortunately situated island, our indomitable persistence in the teeth of odds, and the unstemmed eloquence of our leaders, all of which we shall surely retain. This book is, anyhow, so far as it is anything beyond an attempt to amuse the writer, rather of the nature of suggestion than of prophecy, and many will think it a poor suggestion at that. The suggestion is of a possible remedy for what appears to have always been the chief human ailment, and what will, probably, after these present troubles, be even more pronounced than before. For wars do not conduce to intelligence. They put a sudden end to many of the best intellects, the keenest, finest minds, which would have built up the shattered ruins of the world in due time. And many of the minds that are left are battered and stupefied. The avenues of thought are closed, and people are too tired, too old, or too dulled by violence to build up anything at all. And besides these dulled and damaged minds, there are the great mass of the minds which neither catastrophe nor emotion nor violence nor age nor any other creature can blunt, because they have never been acute, have never had an edge, can cut no ice nor hew any new roads. So, unless something drastic is done about it, it seems like a poor lookout. This book contains the suggestion of a means of cure for this world-old ill, and is offered, free, to a probably inattentive and unresponsive government, a close and interested study of whom has led the writer to believe that the erection of yet another department might not be wholly uncongenial. It will be observed that the general state of the world and of society in this so near and yet so unknown future has been but lightly touched upon. It is unexplored territory, too difficult for the present writer, and must be left to the forecastings of the better informed. A word as to the title of this work, which may seem vague or even foolish. Its source I have given. Food orders we all know. What not was not defined by the user of the phrase, except by the remark that it upset the country. The businesses described in this tale fulfill that definition, and, if they be not what not, I do not know what is. April, 1918. End of section 0. Chapter 1 of What Not by Rose Macaulay. Chapter 1. The Ministry. 1. After the Great War, but I do not say how long after, when the tumult and the shouting had died, and those who were left of the captains and the kings had gone either home or to those obscure abodes selected for them by their more successful fellows, to allay anxiety I hasten to mention that 3 one-time emperors were among those thus relegated to distance and obscurity, and humanity, released from its long torment, peered nervously into a future darkly divined, nervously and yet curiously, like a man long sick who has just begun to get about again and cannot yet make anything coherent of the strange, disquieting, terrifying, yet enchanting jumble which breaks upon his restored consciousness. While these things happened, the train still ran through the Bakerloo tube, carrying people to their day's work. Compartments in tube trains are full of variety and life, more so than in trains above ground, being more congested and having straps, also no class snobbery. Swaying on adjacent straps were a fluffy typist, reading The Love He Could Not Buy in the Daily Mirror, a spruce young civil servant on his way to the Foreign Office, reading The Times, a clergyman reading The Challenge, who looked as if he was interested in the life and liberty movement, another clergyman reading The Guardian, who looked as if he wasn't, an elderly gentleman reading The Morning Post, who looked patriotic but soured, as if he had volunteered for national service during the Great War and had found it disappointing, a young man reading The Post-War, The Alert New Daily, and a citizen with a law-abiding face very properly perusing The Hidden Hand. The Hidden Hand was the government daily paper. Such a paper had for long been needed. It is difficult to understand why it was not started long ago. All other papers are so unreliable, so tiresome. A government must have one paper on which it can depend for unfailing support. So here was the Hidden Hand, and its readers had no excuse for ignorance of what the government desired them to think about its own actions. The carriage was full of men and women going to their places of business. There were tired young men, lame young men, pale and scarred young men, brown and fit young men, bored and blasé young men, jolly and amused young men, and nearly all, however brown or fit or pale or languid or jolly or bored, bore a peculiar and unmistakable impress stamped, faintly or deeply, on their faces, their eyes, their carriage, the set of their shoulders. There were, among the businessmen and girls, women going shopping, impassive, without newspapers, gazing at the clothes of others, taking in their cost, their cut, their colour. This is an engrossing occupation. Those who practice it sit quite still, without a stir, a twinkle, a yawn, or a paper, and merely look, all over, up and down, from shoes to hat. They are a strange and wonderful race of beings, these gazing women. One cannot see into their minds or beyond their roving eyes. They bear less than any other section of the community the stamp of public events. The representatives of the type in the Bakerloo this morning did not carry any apparent impress of the Great War. It would take something more than a Great War, something more even than a food crisis, to leave its mark on these sphinx-like and immobile countenances. Kingdoms may rise and fall, nations may reel in the death grapple, but they sit gazing still, and their minds, amid the rocking chaos, may be imagined to be framing some such thoughts as these. Those are nice shoes. I wonder if they're the ones Swan and Edgar have at 30s. She's trimmed her hat herself, and not well. That skirt is last year's shape. That's a smart coat. Dear me, what stockings! You'd think anyone would be ashamed. These women had not the air of reckless anticipation, of being alert for any happening, however queer, that, in differing degrees, marked the majority of people in these days. For that, in many, seemed the prevailing note, the series of events so surprising as to kill surprise, of disasters so appalling as to numb horror, had come and gone, leaving behind them this reckless touch, and with it a kind of greed, a determination to snatch whatever might be from life before it tumbled again into chaos. They had not been devoid of lessons in what moralists call making the best of it, those staggering years when everything had fallen and fallen, successively and simultaneously, civilization and governments and hopes and crowns and nations and soldiers and rain and tears and bombs and buildings, only not prices or newspapers. For, if everything had so fallen once, it might even now be riding for a fall again, in spite of the League of Nations and other devices for propping up the unsteady framework of a lasting peace. The thing was to get what one could first. The thing, in the opinion of one traveller in that train, was to wear cap and bells, to dance through life to a barrel organ, to defeat a foolish universe with its own weapons. And always there was that sense in the background of a possible great disaster, of dancing on the world's thin crust that had broken once and let one through, and might break again. Its very thinness, its very fragility added a desperate gaiety to the dance. 2. Ivy Delmer, who was not the traveller alluded to above, and did not consciously think or feel any of these things, stood holding to a strap, with a novel which she was going to change in the lunch hour in one hand. Ivy Delmer, a shorthand typist at the Ministry of Drains, was young, ingenuous, soft-faced, naive, and the daughter of a Buckinghamshire vicar. The two things she loved best in the world were marzipan and the drama. Her wide grey eyes travelled, with innocent interest, along the faces in the compartment. She was seeing if she liked them or not. Immaturely and unconsciously sexual, she looked with more hope of satisfaction at male faces than at female. Not but that she was susceptible to strong admirations for her own sex. She had a pash for Miss Doris Keane and Miss Teddy Gerard, and in private life a great esteem for Miss Grammont at the ministry, whose letters she sometimes took down in shorthand. But everyone knows there is a greater number of interesting faces and trains belonging to another sex than to one's own, and it is no use pretending. Having subjected the faces within her range to her half-unconscious judgment, and passed them with varying degrees of credit, Miss Delmer, for lack of anything better to do, read the advertisements and exhortations over the windows. With satisfaction she noted that she had seen all the advertised plays. She absorbed such temporal maxims and eternal truths as, "Let Mr. Mustard mix your bath," "God is not mocked," and the terrifying utterances of the Safety If Possible Council. Is it safe? That is the question. No. That is the answer. If you hope to achieve safety in a street aero, 1. Do not alight before the aero does. 2. Do not attempt to jump up into an aero in motion. Then a picture. A will be killed because he is standing immediately beneath a descending aero bus. B will be killed because he and others like him have shaken the nerve of the aviator. A series of warnings which left one certain that, wherever one might achieve safety, it would not be in, or anywhere at all near, a street aero. That, probably, is the object. In the old days it was the motorbus that was thus made a thing of terror by the princes of the netherworld. Now, even as then, their efforts met with success, and the tubes were filled with a panic-stricken mob. Ivy Delmer, taking an empty seat, saw Miss Grammont at the other side of the carriage. Miss Grammont had the New Statesman and the Tatler, and was reading one of them. She was partial to both, which was characteristic of her attitude towards life. She was one of those who see no reason why an intelligent interest in the affairs of the world should be incompatible with a taste for Eve. She enjoyed both classical concerts and new reviews. She might be called a learned worldling. Ivy Delmer was rather shy of her because of her manner, which could be supercilious, because of her reputed cleverness, and because of her position at the ministry, which was a long way above Ivy's. On the other hand, her clothes made one feel at home. They showed skill and interest. She had not that air of the dowd which some people who have been to college have, and which is so estranging to normal people. Kitty Grammont, something of the elegant rake, something of the gamin, something of the adventuress, something of the scholar, with innocent amber-brown eyes gazing ingenuously from under long black lashes, a slightly cynical mouth, a small, smooth, rounded child's face, a travelled manner, and an excellent brain, was adequately, as people go, equipped for the business of living. She had seen some life, in a past which, if checkered, had not lacked its gaiety, meant to see much more, in a future which she did not foresee clearly, but which she intended should be worthy of her, and was seeing enough to go on with in a present which, though at moments it blackly bored her, she was very susceptible to boredom, was, on the whole, decidedly entertaining. Ivy Delmer, looking at her across the compartment, with some surprise because she was so nearly punctual this morning, this not being one of her habits, admired her greatly, thinking how clever she was, how clearly, how unhesitatingly, how incisively her sentences came out when she was dictating, cutting their way in that cool, light, dragging voice of hers through her subject, however intricate, as a sharp blade cuts ice, quite different from some people's dictation, which trails to and fro, amending, cancelling, hesitating, indistinct, with no edge to it, so that one's shorthand has constantly to be altered, making a mess on the page, and bits of it read aloud to see how it goes now, which was a nuisance, because one can't rely always on being able to read off even one's own shorthand quite fluently straight away like that. Further, and this was nearer Ivy's heart, Miss Grammont wore, as a rule, charming shoes. She also smoked extraordinarily nice cigarettes, and often had delicious chocolates, and was generous with both. All this made it a grief to Ivy Delmer that Miss Grammont's brother and his family, who lived in her father's parish, and with whom Miss Grammont often stayed, were not approved of. Into the reasons for this it will be more appropriate to enter later in this narrative. 3. Oxford Circus. The hub of the world, where seething mobs fought on the platform like wild beasts. Piccadilly Circus. Lucky people, thought Ivy Delmer, who got out there, all among gaiety and theatres. Trafalgar Square. There naval officers got out to visit the Admiralty or the Nelson Column. Charing Cross. There people had got out during the Great War to go and help the War Office or the Ministry of Munitions to run the business. So much help, so much energy, so many hotels. And now there were more than ever, because so much needed doing, and hotels are the means heaven has given us to do it with. At Charing Cross, Ivy Delmer and Kitty Grammont got out, for, without specifying the hotel where the Ministry of Brains carried on its labours, it may be mentioned without indiscretion that it was within a walk of Charing Cross. Miss Grammont and Miss Delmer walked there, Miss Delmer well ahead and hurrying, because to her it seemed late, Miss Grammont behind and sauntering, because to her it seemed superfluously early. The ministry daily day began at 9:30, and it was only 9:40 now. The summer morning was glittering on the river like laughter. A foolish thing it seemed to be going into an hotel on a summer morning, to be sitting down at a government desk laden with government files, taking a government pen, which was never a relief, only a not exactly, and writing pamphlets, or answers to letters which, if left long enough, would surely answer themselves, as is the way of letters, and all to improve the brains of the nation. Bother the brains of the nation, thought Miss Grammont, only she used a stronger word, as was the custom in what Mrs. Delmer called her unfortunate family. Black doubt sometimes smote her as to not so much the efficacy of the work of her department as its desirability, if ever it should be perfectly accomplished. Did brains matter so greatly, after all? Were the clever happier than the fools? Miss Grammont, whose university career had been a brilliant intellectual adventure, felt competent to speak for both these types of humanity. She knew herself to be happier when playing the fool than when exerting her highly efficient brain. The lunatic asylum touch gave her more joy than the studious, and she wore learning like a cap and bells. But stupidity was, of course, a bore. It must, of course, be mitigated if possible. And anyhow, the object of the Ministry of Brains was not to make people happy, that could be left to the Directorate of Entertainments, nor to make them good, that was up to the Church, now, to the great benefit of both, divorced from the state, but to further social progress and avert another great war. Miss Grammont yawned, because the day was yet so young, and followed Miss Delmer up the steps of the hotel. 4. The Ministry of Brains, a vast organization, had many sections. There was the propaganda section, which produced pamphlets and organized lectures and cinema shows. Miss Grammont had been lent temporarily to this section by her own branch. There was the men's education section, the women's and the children's, the section which dealt with brain tests, examinations, certificates and tribunals, and the section which was concerned with the direction of the intellects of the great unborn. Ivy Delmer was attached to this section, and Mr. Delmer, when he heard about it, was not altogether sure it was quite nice for her. "She surely shouldn't know they have any," he had said to his wife, who was weeding, and replied absently, "Any what, dear? Who?" "Intellects," the vicar said. "The unborn. Besides, they haven't." He was frowning and jerking out dandelions from the lawn with a spud. "Oh, that's not it, dear," Mrs. Delmer reassured him vaguely. "Not the just unborn, you know. The ever-so-long unborn. All this arrangement of who ought to marry who. Quite silly, of course, but no harm for Ivy in that way. After all, there's no reason why she shouldn't know that children often inherit their brains from their parents." The vicar admitted that, even for their precious and very young Ivy, there was no great harm in this. The section in question was, as Mrs. Delmer had stated, concerned with the encouragement and discouragement of alliances in proportion as they seemed favourable or otherwise to the propagation of intelligence in the next generation. There were numerous and complicated regulations on the subject, which could not, of course, be enforced. The ministry's methods were those of stimulation, reward, and punishment, rather than of coercion. There were bonuses on the births of the babies of parents conforming to the regulations, and penal taxes on unregulated infants, taxes increasing in proportion to the flagrancy of the parents' disobedience, so that the offspring of parents of very low mental calibre brought with them financial ruin. Everyone held a Ministry of Brains form, showing his or her mental category, officially ascertained and registered. If you were classified A, your brains were certified to be of the highest order, and you were recommended to take a B2 or B3 partner. These were the quite intelligent. To ally yourself with another A or a B1 was regarded as wasteful, there not being nearly enough of these to go round, and your babies would receive much smaller bonuses. If you were classed C1, C2, or C3, your babies would receive no encouragement unless you had diluted their folly with an A partner. If you chose to unite with another C, they were heavily fined, and if you were below C3, i.e. uncertificated, they were fined still more heavily, by whomsoever diluted, and for the third and subsequent infants born under such conditions you would be imprisoned. Only the ministry had not been working long enough for anyone to have yet met with this fate. The children of unions perpetrated before the Mental Progress Act were, at present, exempt. Families among the lower grades and among the uncertificated were thus drastically discouraged. You were uncertificated for matrimonial purposes not only if you were very stupid, but if, though yourself of brilliant mental powers, you had actual deficiency in your near family. If you were in this case, your form was marked A, deficiency. And so on. The details of the regulations, their intricacies and tangled knots, the endless and complicated special arrangements which were made with various groups and classes of persons may be easily imagined, or, rather less easily because the index is poor, found in the many volumes of the Ministry of Brains instructions. Anyhow, to room number 13, which was among the many rooms where this vast and intricate subject was dealt with, Ivy Delmer was summoned this Monday morning to take down a letter for Vernon Trudeau. 5. Vernon Trudeau was a fair, slim, neat, eyeglassed young man. His appearance and manners were approved by Ivy Delmer's standards and his capabilities by the heads of his department. His intellectual category was A. He had an impatient temper, a ready tongue, considerable power over papers, an important gift not possessed by all civil servants, resource in emergency, competence in handling situations and persons, decided personal charm, was the son of one of our more notorious politicians, and had spent most of the war in having malaria on the Struma front, with one interesting break when he was recalled to England by his former department to assist in the drawing up of a new bill, dealing with a topic on which he was an expert. He was, after all this, only 30 now, so had every reason for believing, as he did, that he would accomplish something in this world before he left it. He had been sucked into the activities of the new ministry like so many other able young men and women, and was finding it both entertaining and not devoid of scope for his talents. Ivy Delmer admired him a good deal. She sat at his side with her notebook and pencil, her soft, wide mouth a little parted, waiting for him to begin. He was turning over papers impatiently. He was in a rather bad temper, because of his new secretary, of whom he only demanded a little common sense and did not get it, and he would have to get rid of her, always a tiresome process. He couldn't trust her with anything, however simple. She always made a hash of it, and filled up the gaps, which were profound, in her recollection of his instructions with her own ideas, which were not. He had on Saturday given her some forms to fill up, stock forms which were always sent in reply to a particular kind of letter from the public. The form was supposed merely to say, "In reply to your letter with reference to your position as regards the tax, or bonus, on your prospective, or potential, or existing, infant, I am to inform you that your case is one for the decision of the local tribunals set up under the Mental Progress Act, to whom your application should have been made." Miss Pomfrey, who was young and full of zeal for the cause, she very reasonably wished that the Mental Progress Act had been in existence before her parents had married, had added on her own account to one such letter, "It was the stupidity of people like you who caused the Great War," and put it in this morning with the other forms on Trudeau's table for signing. Trudeau had inquired, fighting against what he knew to be a disproportionate anger with her, didn't she really know better by now than to think that letters like that would be sent? Miss Pomfrey had sighed. She did not know better than that by now. She knew hardly anything. She was not intelligent, even as B3s went. In fact, her category was probably a mistake. Her babies, if ever she had any, would be of a mental calibre that did not bear contemplation. They would probably cause another great war. So Prideau, who had also other worries, was out of temper. "Sorry, Miss Delmer. Ah, here we are." He fidgeted about with a file, then began to dictate a letter in his quick, light, staccato voice. Ivy, clenching the tip of her pink tongue between her teeth, raced after him. "Sir, in reply to your letter of 26th May with reference to the taxation on babies born to your employees and their consequent demand for increased wages, I am instructed by the Ministry of Drains to inform you that this point is receiving his careful attention in connection with the general economic question involved by the terms of Ministry of Drains Instruction 743, paragraph 3. Trudeau paused and frowned nervously at his secretary, who was conducting a fruitless conversation over his telephone, an occupation at which she did not shine. "Hello? Yes. I can't quite hear. Who are you, please?" "Oh. Yes, he's here. But rather busy, you know." "Dictating?" "Yes, dictating. Who did you say wanted him, please?" "Oh, I see." "What is it, Miss Pomfrey?" Trudeau broke in, making her start. "It's the minister's secretary," she explained, without covering the receiver. "He says, will you go to the minister? There's a deputation, of bishops, I think he said, about the new instruction about clergymen's babies. But I said you were busy dictating." Trudeau had jumped to his feet, frowning, and was at the door. You'd better make a note that I'm never busy dictating or doing anything else when the minister sends for me, he shot at her as he left the room. And now he's cross, Miss Pomfrey murmured sadly. I dare say he's only angry at being interrupted, said Ivy Delmer, who had been at the same secretarial college as Miss Pomfrey and thought that her days in the Ministry of Drains were numbered. I do make him cross, Miss Pomfrey observed, accepting the fact with resignation as one of the sad, inevitable fatalities of life, and returned to her indexing. She had been set to make an index of those Ministry of Drains instructions which had come out that month. She had only got to the 11th of the month. The draft fluttered the pages about. Ivy Delmer watched the instructions waving to and fro in the breeze. Number 801, agriculturalists. 798, conscientious objectors. 897, residents in Ireland. 674, parents of more than 3 children. How many there were, thought Ivy, as she watched. How clever the people who dealt with such things needed to be. She thought of her father's village, and the people in it, the agriculturalists, the parents of more than 3 children, all the little human community of lives who were intimately affected by one or other of these instructions, and the fluttering pages emerged from the dry realm to which such as Ivy relegate printed matter and ideas, rules and agreements and arrangements. It touched the living universe that she knew, the courting boys and girls on stiles in Buckinghamshire lanes, Emmeline, the vicarage housemaid, who had married Sid Dean last month, Mr. and Mrs. White at the farm, all the great, stupid, pathetic, aggrieved public, neatly filed letters from whom covered every table in the ministry, awaiting reply, their very handwriting and spelling calculated to touch any heart but a civil servant's. Ivy found a moment in which to hope that everyone in the ministry was being very careful and painstaking about this business, before she reverted to wondering whether or not she liked the colour which Miss Pomfrey had dyed her jersey. Having decided that she didn't, and also that she had better go away and wait for Mr. Prideau to send for her again, she departed. 6. Vernon Prideau, having given his assistance to the minister in the matter of the third clause of the new clergyman's baby's instruction, left the minister and the deputation together and returned to his room via the propaganda branch, which he visited in order to ask Miss Grammont to dine with him that evening. He and Kitty Grammont had known one another for some years. They had begun at Cambridge, where Prideau had been 2 years the senior, and had kept up an intermittent friendship ever since, which had, since their association in the ministry, grown into intimacy. Prideau found Kitty writing a pamphlet. She was rather good at this form of literature, having a concise and clear-cut style and an instinct for stopping on the right word. Some pamphleteers have not this art. They add a sentence or two more and undo their effect. The pamphlet on which Miss Grammont was at this moment engaged was intended for the perusal of the working woman, and bore the conversational title, The Nation Takes an Interest in Your Affairs. Will you not take an interest in the affairs of the nation? Which, as Miss Grammont observed, took rather a long time to say, but may have been worth it. Dine with you. I'll be charmed. Where and when? My rooms, 8 o'clock. I've got my parents and the minister coming. Oh, the minister. Do you mind? No, I'm proud to meet him. I've never yet met him over food, so to speak, only officially. I admire our Chester more every day he lives, don't you? Nature made him and then broke the die. Wonderful man, Prideau agreed. Extraordinary being. A happy touch with bishops, too. Picked that up in the home, no doubt, his father's one. Liking's another thing, of course. By the way, do you know what his category is? However, this is gossip. I must get back and discover what's the latest perpetration of my new secretary. See you tonight, then. He left the room. Kitty Grammont observed with satisfaction, for she was critical of such things, how well his clothes fitted him, wondered what he had nearly told her about the minister's category, finished her pamphlet, and sent it out for typing. She had an idea that this pamphlet might not get passed by the censor, and wanted to find out. For the censor was cautious about pamphlets, wisely opining that you cannot be too careful. Pamphlets may, and usually do, deal with dangerous or indecent topics, such as the future. If sufficiently dangerous and indecent, they become leaflets and are suppressed on sight. There were dangerous and explosive words like peace, war, and freedom, which the censor dealt with drastically. The danger of the word peace dated, of course, from the days when peace had not yet arrived, and discussion of it was therefore improper, like the discussion of an unborn infant. By the time it did arrive, its relation to the region of things we do not mention had become a habit, not likely to be laid aside, so that a Ministry of Drains pamphlet entitled The Peace of Fools had been strangled before birth, the censor being very naturally unable to believe that it did not refer, in some mysterious way, to the negotiations which had ended hostilities, whereas, as a matter of fact, it was all about the foolish content of stupid people who went on submitting to diseases, which a little intelligent thought would have prevented. There had also perished, owing to the same caution on the censor's part, and, it must be presumed, to the same guilty conscience on the part of the government, a booklet published by Messrs. Mowbray in a purple paper cover with a gold cross on it, called The Peace Which Passeth Understanding, not to mention a new edition of Burke's Regicide Peace, and one or two other works of which the censor, whose reading was obliged to be mainly 20th century, mistook the date. And if treatises concerning peace were suspected from force of habit, works on war were discouraged also, on the sound British principle that the stress of a great peace is not the time to talk of war. We must first deal with peace, and then we may think about war. But one thing at once, and do not let us cry war, war, when there is no war. But there may be one day, argued the pamphleteers, and might it not be well to prepare our minds for it? To which the answer very properly was, no, Britons do not look ahead. They come through instead. And anyhow, it was treachery to those who were spending their energies on this righteous peace to discuss a premature war, which could neither be just nor lasting. Another improper subject, naturally, was liberty. That needs no explanation. It has always been improper in well-regulated countries, like eugenics or the poor, and has received no encouragement from authority. Notwithstanding this, so many improper works upon it, in every conceivable form, have always been produced, that the censors had to engage a special clerk, who had just obtained a first class in English literature at Oxford, and who therefore had books and pamphlets of all dates fresh in her memory, to check their researches and inform them when their energies were superfluous. Not that all the books of former centuries on this topic were to be encouraged, for, after all, one period is in some respects singularly like another, and the same reflection strangely germane to both. Naturally, therefore, when the literary clerk, seeing advertised a new and cheap edition of Robert Hall's Sentiments Proper to the Present Crisis, and, remembering the trend of this work, sent for it, having sold her own copy at Blackwell's when she went down, and read such remarks as, "Freedom, driven from every spot on the continent, has sought an asylum in a country which she always chose for her favourite abode, but she is pursued even here and threatened with destruction. It is for you to decide whether this freedom shall yet survive, or be clothed with a funeral pall and be wrapped in eternal gloom." Very properly she reported the matter to headquarters, and the cheap edition was called in. Equally naturally there perished, without the help of the literary clerk, who was not asked to judge of 20th-century literature, various collections of free verse, for which the poetry bookshop was successfully raided, a tract of the sort which is dropped about trains, published by the Evangelical Tract Society, and called "Throw Off Your Chains! Citizens of a Free City," which was found at Mowbray's, and bore on its title page the statement, "Jerusalem is free," a manifest and seditious untruth, as we, of course, held Jerusalem in trust for the Jews, and many others of like tendency, such as works on free food, free drink, free housing, free love, free thought and labour, in chains. Even fiction was suspect.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.